Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another episode in our beautiful series on the Gates of Goodness. With you is Brother Sulaiman Salim. And with us here, we have some esteemed guests. We have Brother Abdullah and Brother Muhammad. And we have Sheikh Idris and Sheikh Ilyas. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve our guests for today. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we want to move into another beautiful and motivational talk on the topic of never lose hope in the mercy of Allah. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. But before we get into that, let us talk a little about what we began introducing in the first episode, which is the beautiful experience of Ramadan and how to make this month better than any other month of our past. So we started talking last time about some of the ways we can make Ramadan a great experience for ourselves, some of the ways to succeed in the month of Ramadan. We mentioned some of the tips such as time management, such as taking advantage of every hour of every day. We talked a little about how to make it an experience where we believe that every day is our last in order to benefit as much as possible. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this Ramadan better than any Ramadan in our past. So one of the things we didn't really get to touch upon, which is very crucial to the introduction of Ramadan, is the issue of being grateful. Being grateful to Allah for everything that we have. And oftentimes, subhanAllah, we hear the example of a young person opening the refrigerator. They look in the refrigerator and they say, I have nothing to eat. But subhanAllah, they have so many different options, so many different things. And they don't realize what blessings they have. They don't realize how much Allah has blessed them with. Oftentimes, maybe a man will say to his wife, why don't you cook something new today? I don't want to eat any leftovers. Every day it has to be something new, where leftovers are considered something, you know, second class or something like this. And we see around us, subhanAllah, in our times, 800 million people. 800 million people are on the verge of starvation. And every year, for the last 3 years, 2.5 million children have died every single year as a result of hunger-related causes. And subhanAllah, we come to eat every single day. We come to iftar knowing that there will be iftar. But some people, they look for their iftar every day. They're searching, on their knees, they're searching, not knowing if they will make it, they will live long enough to find something to eat. And so my question is this, before we move into our new topic, my question is, what are some ways, some realistic ways, we can express our gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a daily basis? So that in the month of Ramadan, we're being expressive with our gratitude to Allah, and so it will last long term. We'll have something after the month of Ramadan. And so one example of this that somebody suggested is to make dua for those who are suffering right before you break your fast. So we can start maybe with Brother Abdullah. What are some ways you think we can express our gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Sharing, like, you know, this time, this money, this life, this food is not yours in the first place. He's like, you're just like here for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and like you are like one of the reasons like for this. Like, you should share everything you have. Like, if you have money, you should share. If you have food now, not just like making dua. Making dua is great if you can do this, but like sharing, searching, you should go and like, you should search hard for this. Like, especially for people who need this, like, start giving them. And like, you should be thankful for Allah, because you're not thankful for you. You are one of the reasons Allah, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless, and like, you're just like delivering it, like a delivering man. Not like, you know, I'm taking the money for me, no. I'm taking the money for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm doing the things for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So sharing, for sure.
MashaAllah. Jazakallah khair. Akhi Muhammad, do you have anything to share?
I think that for us, I mean, three tamras won't make a difference to us, but to someone else, it's gonna make a huge difference. I mean, you can last more than 3 days on just one tamra each day. So, like he said, sharing. Just share as little as possible.
Absolutely. Jazakumullah khairan. Sheikh Idris.
I think one of the best ways to help yourself be thankful is to look at those who are less fortunate than you. It will always help you to know what you really have. It's one of the best advice I always give to my family and to others, is that don't look at the people who have more than you, because it will depress you and you will think that, you know, you want to be in their shoes. Absolutely. When you look at the person who doesn't have a house, the people who don't have a family, they don't have food, it will help you to really appreciate what you have.
Jazakallahu khairan.
Everyone said everything I would have mentioned, but I think one of the ways that we can increase in being grateful for God's our food is always remembering Allah as we put each morsel of food in our mouth. You know, sometimes we even forget to say Bismillah when we start eating.
Yeah.
But I think like every time we're putting something in our mouth, Bismillah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, remembering Allah, it will help us to be thankful. Also just to remember Allah a lot more, because Ramadan shouldn't be the month in which we go crazy when it comes to iftar. It should be the time when we start refining ourselves and eating enough so we can pray with some khushu', not,
you know,
not praying and we can't breathe.
No. Jazakallah khairan. Those are all amazing pieces of advice. One of the things one of my scholars, one of my teachers reminded me of is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us in Surah Ibrahim, verse 7, وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. Your Lord proclaimed that if you're grateful to me, I will increase you. I will give you more of your blessings. And so there are many different ways to express our gratitude, all of which you guys have mentioned, mashallah. And one of those ways is when we come to eat iftar every day, and this is related to what you were saying, is try not to put more on your plate than you actually need. And so usually as human beings, we get really hungry, we think we're going to eat everything. We want everything. And if this is why a lot of people, they don't go shopping for food when they're hungry or they're fasting. They'll end up buying everything. So when we put our food, when we serve ourselves or if we're eating from a shared plate, the best thing to do is to put very little. And there's multiple benefits in this, which is the first thing is you're being grateful for the little that you have. And you're knowing yourself, because once you eat that amount, your brain starts to register your full way before you go serve yourself a second time. And the third thing is so you can have khushu'. Because when we eat too much, we end up being stuffed, we end up being lazy and tired. So we go to Salatul Taraweeh and we're tired, we can't focus, and everybody just wants to end the Salah, they want to leave, they want to sit down, they're thinking about when they're going to get home and sleep. SubhanAllah, even before we started, one of the brothers was mentioning how, you know, we overstuff ourselves and we're so tired in Taraweeh, yes. so tired, SubhanAllah. And so one thing we can do is to share as much as possible, to give in charity, especially in the month of Ramadan. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was even more generous in the month of Ramadan. And he was the most generous person throughout the year, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we can find different avenues, different ways to help people who are suffering, such as going out and finding them yourself, or even going through some kind of organization. We can help them by making dua for them. We can help them by not focusing on what we don't have, but what we already do have. And so one thing that you mentioned, Sheikh Idris, is how the Prophet ﷺ reminded us, when you're looking at people, look at the people who have less than you of the dunya. Look at the people who have less than you. So oftentimes we go through hardships. We don't realize that what we're going through, somebody would wish to be in our shoes. They wouldn't mind the hardship, because what they're going through is way worse. And so this is one of the ways to show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are several of the ways. And so we want to transition that topic into the topic of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by mentioning the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's actually directly related to what we have in the month of Ramadan of blessings, and even afterwards and onwards. And so the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we can talk about it for hours and days, and we would be here, we wouldn't be able to go anywhere else. But the most important thing we want to cover today, inshallah ta'ala, is la taqnatu min rahmatillah. Do not despair or lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Never lose hope in the mercy of Allah. This includes not to lose hope in the mercy of Allah when it comes to our hardships, because we all go through hardships. And this includes do not lose hope in the mercy of Allah when it comes to our sins, knowing that Allah will forgive all sins as long as we are sincere. And the first example, some people wonder about it. You know, how can we possibly lose hope when we go through hardships? We look around us at the Muslim ummah right now and we're suffering everywhere. Everywhere, the Muslims are suffering all over the world. And there are people suffering of all walks of life. And it takes a lot of faith and a lot of hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a lot of strength and a lot of tawakkul, reliance upon Allah during these difficult times, to remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of the situation. He's aware of the oppression we go through. He's aware of our difficulties. He's aware of our hardships. And sometimes something will happen to us. We think it's the worst thing in the world. Mm-hmm. But it turns out to be the greatest blessing of our lives. And I'll mention even a personal example. I was in Dublin, Ireland, and I met some amazing people in Ireland. MashaAllah, the community there is amazing. And we were coming back from a community camp. So we were talking about the hereafter, paradise and hellfire. On the way back, we're on a bus. And on the highway, suddenly the back of the bus, there's a loud explosion, like a loud boom. And everyone started panicking. You know, we had the sisters in the back, the brothers in the front. So the sisters, they actually panicked a little more, subhanAllah. And then we pull over and we get out. And the bus driver finds out that one of the tires of the bus had just exploded. Just for no reason, just exploded. And they called, you know, a tow truck. They called a repair person. But as they were looking at the highway, they couldn't find anything at all that could have caused the explosion of the tire. There was no indication that anything had caused it. It was so random, subhanAllah. So as we got back on the bus an hour later, an hour and a half later, you know, we were giving a reminder to one another that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives us things and we should be patient, we should trust Allah, we should know that the mercy of Allah is beyond our imagination. He's planning for every one of us better than we can plan for ourselves. And so as we were saying this, subhanAllah, we said, it could have been that we continued on this highway and something bad could have happened. And as we were saying this, literally a few minutes later, we reached a portion of the highway where the entire highway was closed off and there were multiple, you know, emergency vehicles, police and ambulance and fire trucks, people being carried out, like people had passed away. There were so many cars in the wreck and we had to take a detour. And if we had been there, Allahu Alam, it could have been us in that accident. But when you realize that Allah is planning for you better than you plan for yourself, then you're always happy. You're always content no matter what happens. This is part of having hope in the mercy of Allah. And so the longer the trial goes, like the longer the fitna is, like for some of our brothers and sisters in other countries, they're going through prolonged periods of oppression, dhulm, real oppression. And when they go through this oppression, they realize and they remember that Allah is taking care of them. Allah's mercy is beyond them. The hope in Allah never runs out. And so this is what leads us to the second aspect, and I want everyone to chime in, inshallah ta'ala, is about not losing hope in the mercy of Allah when it comes to our sins, especially in the month of Ramadan. Ramadan, a lot of times people come to pray in the masjid, people start to worship more, and other people are sitting there criticizing them, you know, as Ramadan Muslims. Without a doubt, we want to be great throughout the year. We want to be great throughout the year. But during the month of Ramadan, we want this to be a turning point for the masses, for most of the Muslims. So what we're going to do, inshallah ta'ala, is we're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we'll talk in depth about how to have mercy in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, before we go to the break, because it's going to be like a Ramadan-related break, inshallah ta'ala, the one thing that we want to remind ourselves about, and this verse, every Muslim should know this verse by heart, every non-Muslim studying Islam should know this verse, is the verse from Surah Az-Zumar, verse 53, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Do not despair from the mercy of Allah. Allah is speaking to us. Do not despair from the mercy of Allah. And so I want to ask, what are some ways you feel we can always remember that the hope and the mercy in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is vast and endless? We can start over here, inshallah.
Actually, you just remember like why Allah created you. Oh. Allah created you for a reason. Everything happens for a reason. Like Allah made you do this because He wants you to get back to Him. So like whenever sin happened, or like you made a sin, for example, like remember like Allah wants you to come back to Him closer and closer and closer. Like you remember why He created you and He loves you. Really, He loves you, I mean.
One of the things that just keep you going is that believing that Allah has a much better plan than yours, much better. So you're always satisfied, you know. You don't want to interrupt with His plan. You can't. And that's one of the things that keep you like satisfied all the way. Even if something bad happens, you're still satisfied. Just alhamdulillah, this is much better than what I have in mind.
Alhamdulillah, jazakallah khair. And one thing we can also, maybe you can chime in on this, is as Muslims, we balance our faith, as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimullah says, we balance our faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala between three things. And so the main thing that's driving us is the love of Allah. And the two things that we need to balance this out is the hope in Allah, never lose hope, and to always have fear, of course, of the consequences and the punishment. Do you want to chime in on this, Sheikh Idris?
If I would say anything, I would say that it's a good thing that we have to focus our the way we think of Allah. A lot of times we have this feeling of Allah that we think of Him a certain way, but it's more in the way of that we think of people, and we confuse the two. And the similitude is like, for instance, I tell people sometimes, say you have a mother of a child, and the mother is horrible. She doesn't feed him, she beats him, she just ignores him. When that child is hurt, what is the first thing that he does? He runs to the mother, no matter what she does to him. And this is a human who doesn't even deserve this love. The child never lose hope in the mother. Why? Because it's a pure love and a pure understanding. Allah is greater than this mother. Of course, yes. It wouldn't be this way. No. So we should be the same way as this child. No matter what happens to you, yes. Don't lose hope in Allah. Run back to Him no matter what.
Absolutely.
The same way the child runs to the mother no matter what.
SubhanAllah. Jazakumullah khairan. So we were told that the report is actually ready. We're going to take a short break, inshallah ta'ala. We're going to go to a beautiful reminder about Ramadan, a report that will help us, inshallah ta'ala, get reconnected to Allah and have trust and hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Stick around. We'll be right back, inshallah. We will.
month of Ramadan is a month of repentance, is a month that the doors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is open. So Allah, as he stated in Quran, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. As a mankind, we can be very stingy, we can be very angry towards each other, but whatever mistake we make towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is most merciful, most forgive us. So come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and never lose the hope from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Definitely, because sometimes for family region or different region, we felt, you know, hopeless. But when we go to say prayer, or sometimes in Ramadan or apart from Ramadan, if we practice this one, then we can cover those things.
There's sometimes that you feel you have been doing maybe very, very bad sin or something like that, but you never lose hope in Allah, because Allah says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. So never give hope, because the mercy of Allah is always is bigger than whatever sin you have done. We will.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to Gates of Goodness. We were discussing the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you had just heard. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Do not despair from the mercy of Allah. We're going to turn to our brother here, Shaykh Ilyas, and we're going to talk a little about some of the other ways to keep our hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to always strive for His mercy. Tafadla, Shaykh.
Na barak rafiq. I think in regards to looking at the mercy of Allah in regards to our sins, you know, you mentioned the ayah. But then straight after that, Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Allah forgives all sins. You know, so when we're looking at the word rahmah, we're looking at the word, you know, al-istighfar and these words, what you realize is that when you look at Allah's names and attributes, He has all of these all of the time. Al-ghafur, al-ghafar. Wow. You know, when you learn a little bit more about the Arabic language, you realize that these terms, doesn't mean Allah just forgives you once, He forgives over and over and over again, so you can always go back. You know, Allah tells us in the Quran, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ to flee to Allah. You know, in the Ahadith, the Prophet ﷺ told us that Allah divided His mercy into 99 parts. You know, just one He sent down for us, for everyone in dunya, from the Muslim, the non-Muslim, for the animals, but the rest are with Him for the Day of Judgment. You know, so you could be like the worst sinner, the worst of the worst, but then you read the ahadith, or you hear the ahadith about the last person who's going to get into paradise and what he's going to have. You know, subhanAllah. And there's so many ahadith. We're just discussing with some brothers recently about the man on the Day of Judgment is going to see 99 scrolls.
Yes.
All of them as far as his eyes can see. And Allah asks him, do you have any excuses? Do you reject on what the two, or it's like the two angels wrote down? He says, I've got no excuse. I've done it. And he said, just take one bataqa, just one card will be taken out of the statement, La ilaha illallah. And then he'll put both this statement and the 99 scrolls as far as the eye can see on the scales, and subhanAllah, this La ilaha illallah will outweigh all of what he done.
No.
90, it's a lot of scrolls. Oh, it's a lot of scrolls, and Allah knows best. You know, we need to not have this mercy. You need to not have this despair in Allah's mercy, because Allah's mercy is greater than the sins that you're committing.
Absolutely. Jazakallah khair. That's very beautiful. Maybe one question we can ask is this: what happens if somebody has so much emphasis? We mentioned we need both hope in Allah and we need also fear of the consequences. Now, maybe I'll turn over here to Brother Abdullah. What happens if somebody has so much emphasis on the hope but they don't have any fear of the consequences?
He will just stop doing anything good, because yeah, like, I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I'm hoping, like, you know, that He will like let me inside His Jannah and like His paradise and stuff like this, so I'll not do anything, like, you know, I'll stop doing anything good.
Exactly.
But don't go extreme, like, الرفق في كل شيء, like, you know, be like fair and trust in everything.
That's true. How about if somebody, Brother Muhammad, what if somebody goes to the other extreme? They have so much fear, so much, and they don't really focus on the hope and the mercy of Allah.
He'd be too scared, like, from the consequences of what he'd do if he did a bad thing, but he wouldn't do the good things as well. So he wouldn't do the bad things, but he still wouldn't do the good things.
Yes.
Or the opposite. He'd just be like neutral. No good things, no bad things.
Jazakallahu khairan. We're told now that because we're going live, we can actually open up the floor to questions for any callers, inshallah ta'ala. The phone number's on the screen if you want to call, inshallah. And so one of the things, as we're waiting for the first calls to be filtered out, one of the things we want to remind ourselves about is the hadith reported by Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah that's very important for every Muslim to know. It's a hadith Qudsi, so Allah is speaking. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O son of Adam, as long as you call upon me, إِنَّكَ مَا دَعَوْتَنِي وَرَجَوْتَنِي غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنْكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي. As long as you just call upon Allah, He says, I will forgive you for all of your sins and I do not mind. Now, does anybody want to comment maybe, when Allah says, وَلَا أُبَالِي, I do not mind, why is Allah adding this? Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala adding this?
Now, the reason that comes to mind is that, as long as you call on me, I don't mind. You know, whatever you're doing, it's not gonna restrict my mercy upon you. Yes. I don't mind. You could be doing the worst of the worst. I don't mind because my mercy, it supersedes the wrongs that you're doing.
Absolutely. Jazakallah khairan. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ibn Adam, لو بلغت ذنوبك عنان السماء ثم استغفرتني غفرت لك ولا أبالي. If your sins were to reach the clouds of the skies and then you turn back to me, seeking forgiveness from me, I will forgive you and I do not mind. Some of the scholars, they said, وَلَا أُبَالِي here, the reason Allah is adding this, He's not saying, I don't mind, like go ahead. He's saying, I want to forgive you. And Brother Abdullah, maybe you can add on to this. Is there like a hadith or an ayah referring to what if we didn't ask Allah for, what if we didn't sin at all?
لَوْ لَمْ تُذْنِبُوا لَذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِقَوْمٍ غَيْرَكُمْ. يعني if you didn't like do any sins or stuff like this, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would like would replace you like with some other people, like they would like make sins and they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will like kind of forgive them, and they will like he will be like kind of this stuff. But the repentance, Sheikh Sulaiman also like has like kind of, I don't know, maybe three stages.
Yeah, we can do that right after the hadith, inshallah. I'm gonna get back to you on the conditions of repentance. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. The third part of the hadith, so we can finish it off. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ibn Adam, إِنَّكَ لَوْ أَتَيْتَنِي بِقُرَابِ الْأَرْضِ خَطَايَا ثُمَّ لَقِيتَنِي لَا تُشْرِكْ بِي شَيْئًا لَأَتَيْتُكَ بِقُرَابِهَا مَغْفِرًا. Allah is saying, O son of Adam, if your sins were as great as the entire earth, covering the entire earth, wallahi, can we imagine our sins to cover the entire earth? And then you were to die, and then come back to me, we return back to Allah, having not associated partners with me. So you believe in only in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا إله إلا الله. He says, I will come to you with forgiveness as great as it. The mercy of Allah is not limited. Nobody can limit the mercy of Allah. Mm. There is no sin, as you said, there is no sin that is more vast than the mercy of Allah. How can you limit that which is vast? And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-ghaffar, al-ghafur, al-afu. And one of the dua we make, the supplications in the month of Ramadan is, Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbu al-afwa fa'afu anna. Oh Allah, you're the one, you're the afu, you're the one who loves to forgive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy is lasting. Now, Brother Abdullah, you wanted to mention some of the conditions. What if somebody wants to turn back to Allah? Where do they start?
Actually, like, you have to admit it, like you did something wrong. Like I read this, like you have to admit it, like you did something wrong, and like you say, I'm sorry, and like you commit or like pledge, like not doing this again. So, like you have to admit it, like may Allah, like my Creator, like please forgive me. I've done something really wrong, and I admit, I'm saying I'm sorry. I will not like kind of commit this again. It's like it has to be like kind of pure. Like a repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Jazakallah khairan. So one of the conditions, some of the scholars say there's three or five. Mm. Somebody once came to the masjid, he said, where do I go to do tawbah? What am I supposed to do? Mm. I said, you don't even have to come to the masjid for tawbah. He's like, do I have to speak to like an imam? Do I have to confess to someone? Like, no, there's no confession in Islam. It's between you and Allah. The first thing you have to absolutely do if you want to start the act of tawbah is to have the sincerity. Mm-hmm. This is assuming there's five conditions. So you have to have the sincerity that you're actually repenting. It cannot be empty or superficial. The second thing is you have to stop committing the sin. Mm-hmm. So somebody who's stealing money can't say, oh Allah, I'm repenting, oh Allah, I'm repenting, but they're still stealing. Mm-hmm. So you got to stop, seize the sin immediately. The third thing is there has to be remorse, regret in the heart that, oh Allah, I repent to you and I really feel the remorse for this. I feel really bad about this. Ibn al-Qayyim says some people, they'll enter Jannah because of a sin that they commit because they're always thinking about that sin. Mm-hmm. They're always having remorse and regret. So we're always thinking, you know, I fell so short with Allah. I did so much wrong. And they're always turning back to Allah because of that one sin that they committed. Mm. And so we have that condition of having the remorse or the regret. And the next condition that the scholars mention is this person has to vow as much as possible to never return to that sin. And this is where a lot of people get tricked, because somebody actually, you know, people ask this question all the time. Somebody might actually think, what if I know I'm going to fall back into the sin? And the answer to this, does anybody want to chime in? The answer to this is we shouldn't assume already that we're going to be doing the sin again. It goes back to the issue of sincerity. And even if you were sincere and you repented and Allah forgave you, you fell back into it, just go back to Allah. As many times as you fall short, go back to Allah. As long as we continue having tawbah as a companion in our lives, we'll never fall short. Mm-hmm. Do you want to add anything to the conditions of tawbah or to the act of tawbah?
Something that the scholars mentioned as well is that, you know, if you have taken someone's rights, so if I steal Sheikh Idris's money, yeah. I have to give him back his money. I can't say, oh, Allah forgive me for stealing his money. I have to rectify that with him as well. Something that Prophet said is another tawbah. Mm-hmm. Like the regret is like tawbah, because when you have that feeling in your heart that you've, you know, made that mistake, that alone, inshallah, will be able to push you towards to making that tawbah, to making that repentance, inshallah.
Absolutely, jazakallah khair. And this is the fifth condition. So if you took the rights of someone else, you have to return back that right. And this tawbah all has to be done before a person passes away. No. So tawbah, the condition is that you have to be alive. Mm. Because after we leave this world, we can't do tawbah anymore. Mm. And when the sun rises from the west, there's no more tawbah. Mm. This is one of the conditions they mentioned. Now, sometimes our brothers and sisters, and even us, we might fall into this, they see themselves in a very dark situation. Mm. Like there's no light, there's no hope, there's no way out. Everything they did is so much. They don't know where to start. Where do they start? How can they start earning the mercy of Allah? What are some pragmatic, realistic ways, some actual things they can do right now, today, maybe right after this episode, inshallah, to start working towards the mercy of Allah? Any suggestions?
I just want to add one thing.
Yes, absolutely.
A true believer would see like his sin like as the kind of a really big like kind of mountain. Yes. Like so, like if you feel like so bad about something you did, like you should have like felt like the opposite, like feel good, because like, you know, you have this kind of conscious, have this kind of iman that tells you did something wrong and you have to go and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And like a disbeliever, we see like kind of his sin like as of like a fly, like he's kind of, you go away, really, like, you know. So like when you like kind of feel bad and I kind of feel like you, oh no, my gosh, I can't do this, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me, no, just like go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just ask for forgiveness.
Absolutely, jazakumullah khairan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of us and our brothers and sisters, those who are alive and those who have passed away. Amen. We're going to take a short break, inshallah ta'ala. Stick around and we'll be right back. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back from the beautiful reminder. So before we took a break, we were discussing the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and some of the ways of viewing our sins and viewing the hope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this leads us into the topic of what are the consequences of the sins that we actually commit. And so maybe we can have an open discussion on this. You know, all the sins that we are committing, major and minor, they do have an impact on us. They do affect us. They affect us in the dunya and in the akhirah, especially if they're unrepentant from. And so what are some of the consequences that you guys feel, you can chime in here, are affecting us directly as a result of the sins that we commit? We can start over here maybe with brother.
It will just like kind of sadden your heart. Yeah. Seriously, like it makes you kind of physically, mentally, like kind of occupied and like really maybe sick. Because like, you know, like you always think about it, I've done something bad. And you always do something like sinning, I don't know, like drinking, doing this and this and this. So it affects your body physically and mentally. Because like, you know, you're being, I don't know, I have good friends, but I cannot go to them because I'm so bad. Because maybe they will reject me. I can't go there. Like, you always like lose time. It's so, like sad in your heart and like mind.
JazakAllah khairan. Brother Muhammad?
I think that the connection between a human being and Allah is between hub, love. And if you do something that would make someone like upset from you, both of you wouldn't be on good terms with each other, right?
No.
So it will disturb you normally.
No.
So it's the same thing. I mean, if you sin, you wouldn't feel right. No. Just simple as possible.
JazakAllah khairan. Sheikh Idris?
I think mostly the worst thing about the idea of sins is if you don't repent, it will affect your relationship with Allah.
No.
It will affect your ability to do good deeds. Allah is the one who helps us do good deeds. So without His help, it brings you further away from Him, thus affecting your life. Because good deeds is what cleanses the heart, right. What makes anyone feel good. Even non-Muslims, when they do something good, they feed someone, it feels good. Right. This is from fitrah, you know, something that we feel. So the biggest effect on this is that it affects your good deeds.
Yes.
And it keeps you from, you know, memorizing Quran and all of the good deeds that you think about that get you closer to Allah, it can affect it.
Absolutely.
So tawbah and repentance from these is important, yeah, so that we can balance this. Back to your, how you said about balancing, yeah, the things.
JazakAllah khair. Sheikh, yes?
I'm not really sure I can add on. There's so many things to add on. But yeah, you know, you mentioned Surah Mutaffifin, كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مِمَا كَانُوا يَكْتِبُونَ. That there's ran, just like this blackness that goes on a person's heart because of what they used to do. And we know that when a person commits a sin, like a black dot is placed on their heart, you know. So sooner or later, you know, if we keep on committing these bad deeds, then our hearts are just going to turn black and we're going to be overcome. We're just going to be, you know, people. It's bad deeds and sins will become easy to us.
Seal your heart.
Yes. Yeah, your heart will be sealed.
Your heart will be sealed, you know. None of us want that.
No.
So, na'udhu billah. So one of the things that Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah mentioned, I always felt was amazing. He said that one of the greatest punishments for a sin is that it leads to another one.
Yes.
You know, this is amazing. Sometimes we think of, sometimes you want to get that iman boost, you look at, okay, what's the punishment for this, what's the punishment for that? And we're always thinking about the effect in akhirah.
No.
But sometimes if you think about it, like that effect in dunya, you might tell that one white lie, and then it might lead to another one, and then another one, and then another one, and then eventually you're just stuck in a situation that
a liar.
It's very hard for you to get, yeah,
you can't get out.
You can't get out of it, you know. So, you know, when we're talking about sins and the effect on us, like we mentioned, has health benefits, it affects our relationship between people, it affects our relationship with Allah. So really we need to look at that and try our best to cut down on them.
Jazakallah khairan. Another thing, I think you guys will remember this as well, is that the Prophet indicated to us that a person might be prevented from a rizq or a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of a sin that they're committing. Mm. So you don't know how much good, how much khayr is out there for you. It's ready for you, but your sin is blocking it from entering into your life. And if all you had to do, just turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, repent to Allah, sincere repentance, you would start to see the blessings of Allah come upon you. And this is what leads us to, what is the benefit of making istighfar and tawbah and things like that? Go ahead.
Just the story that came in my mind from the people of Musa. You know, he was with the Bani Israel in the wilderness.
Nah.
And, you know, they needed rain.
Yeah.
And, you know, they were making dua, and then the last rain cloud disappeared. And they said, oh, what's going on? And so Musa was told that the reason why this rain is being prevented from you is because one person from you is committing is a sin, and he has to come forward and announce it.
Yeah.
You know, and the person didn't come forward, but he made istighfar, he made tawbah secretly or in private, and when he done that and stopped doing that, then Allah, he sent down the rain on that group of people. Just when you said it, just...
Yeah, that's a beautiful reminder, subhanAllah. Mm-hmm. Also, I think in that same narration, it was mentioned how, I think it was asked, who was the person?
Yeah, who was the person? Yes. Yeah, and he didn't come forward, yes.
And Allah had concealed for this person for such a long time.
SubhanAllah.
And Allah does conceal our sins. First time, second time. Allahu a'lam, how many times this person might commit a sin, try to go back to Allah. Now, even with the issue of sins, the one that we should be sad about, the people we should be afraid for, as one of the scholars said, is the one who commits the sin with arrogance or pride.
Mm.
Whereas somebody else is committing a sin and they're just weak or they're lazy or they're for some other reason.
Mm.
But this person at least is trying to get back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the first one, the one who commits it with pride or arrogance, is literally following in the path of Iblis,
the
shaytan. Because his act of kufr was in the presence of Allah, the ultimate form of kufr, and it was with arrogance. Like this is how arrogance blinds our judgment. This is how pride really destroys a person inside and out. And it leads to many other sins as well. Walayadu billah. So with the issue of istighfar, maybe we can mention the narration of Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah, how one guy came to him and he said, you know, we don't have any rain over here, we don't have any crops, what should we do? He said, seek the forgiveness from Allah, make istighfar. And then somebody later on else came to him and said, my wife is barren, she cannot have children. He said, seek forgiveness from Allah, make istighfar. And somebody else came and said, I complain of poverty, I'm very poor. He said, seek the forgiveness from Allah. And so his students are like, you're just giving the same answer to everyone? Like, what kind of scholar is this? You're just giving the same answer to everybody who comes, you know, with a question. He says, don't you remember the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The verses from Surah Nuh? فقلت استغفروا ربكم إنه كان غفارا. So he said, seek the forgiveness from Allah. He is the one who loves and continuously forgives. يرسل السماء عليكم مدرارا ويمددكم بأموال وبنين ويجعل لكم جنات ويجعل لكم أنهارا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings down the rain to you in abundance, meaning you'll have the crops that you need, the life that you need in this world, the food and the sustenance. And he will give you, grant you offspring, and he'll give you wealth. People want wealth, all the things that people strive for, and he'll give you gardens. And all of this was a result of seeking forgiveness from Allah. And he also mentioned the example of, you know, maybe we can ask this as a trivia question. What are the two things that protect us from the punishment or consequences of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is mentioned in Surah Al-Anfal. And so one of these is gone. It's no longer with us. And that is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ. Allah would not punish them, the people, while you're with them. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. Allah would not forgive them as long as they continue seeking istighfar, forgiveness from Allah. Now there's a hadith that's mentioned, it's a da'if hadith, it's weak, but the scholars all said the meaning behind it is absolutely true. Where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ لَزِمَ الْإِسْتِغْفَارُ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ مِنْ كُلِّ دِيقٍ مَخْرَجًا وَمِنْ كُلِّ هَمٍ فَرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Whoever makes a lot of istighfar, Allah will make for this person out of every difficult situation a way out. And from every hardship or anxiety, relief, the relief that we all seek. And he will bless this person from sources they never expected or imagined. And anybody who makes a lot of istighfar, we can testify to this. We can really attest that this is true. You make a lot of istighfar, you'll notice the doors of khair, the opportunity opening up all around you. You guys agree with this?
Yes.
Absolutely. And so this is from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this also goes back to the ayat. And so making a lot of istighfar, what is a realistic way we can ask right now for us to start a new habit for someone who does not have this habit already? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made istighfar 70 times a day, in one narration 100, and this is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He doesn't need to make istighfar, but he is. And he's teaching us a lesson. So what are some realistic ways, maybe we can start with Brother Abdullah, where we can start a new habit of istighfar for someone who's never done this before as a habit?
You just take it step by step. I would say like maybe like set a reminder. There are great apps now on your iPhone like or Android, like blah, blah, blah. That tells you like every 10 minutes, like, you know, astaghfirullah, like subhanallah, alhamdulillah, stuff like this. And take it step by step. And it will be like a habit after a while. Like I find myself like wallahi, like on the road is crowded and stuff like this. La ilaha illallah, astaghfirullah. I found myself saying this without even like being aware of this. So to be a habit for you. So take it step by step and make it a habit. It will be to stick to you, inshallah.
Do you want to add anything to that?
I want to add something to istighfar as well.
Yeah.
Anything you do in this life, anything you say, you feel it after time. So every time you say astaghfirullah, time by time, you start feeling it inside.
Yeah.
So, because astaghfirullah isn't just the word you're saying.
Right.
You have to feel it inside. And anything you say, like, a lot, you start feeling it inside by time.
Absolutely. Jazakallah khairan. Do you want to add anything to that, Sheikh Khadij?
I would say it's a motivation for most of us. Just think of istighfar as imagine, go back to the similitude of a child.
Yes.
When you upset your mother, and then she became happy with you again. How did you feel? Oh. You felt amazing, like you're on top of the world when you were a child. Now imagine Allah.
Yeah.
So when you seek his istighfar, you know, knowing that he will forgive you, it should cleanse you and give you that good feeling. And remember also that going to him is something that he loves. Just because you think he's not answering or listening, he's listening and he's there. Going to him is what he loves.
Yeah.
And sometimes he holds back from you so that you can keep coming to him. And keep coming to him so that he can raise your levels.
Absolutely.
Making dua to him, keep coming to him so that this is his love for you.
No.
I mean, the person doesn't want to give you just a small reward. I want to give you a great reward, so keep coming so that I can have a reason to raise you and raise you and raise you and raise you.
Is there any sin that Allah would not forgive?
Except for shirk.
While a person's alive.
Oh, while they're alive? No.
Is there any sin that you guys can think of?
No.
So while a person is alive, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we always remember, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. It does remind us though, there's a hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned the example of a person who commits a sin and Allah covers for them that night. But then they go out the next day and they expose it to the whole world.
Mm.
Allah is concealing your sins for you to give you more chances to go back to Him. Why are you exposing it to the world? But when it comes to sins, generally speaking, there's no sin. There's nothing that you could have done in the past that Allah would not forgive you for as long as you're sincere. And this could maybe lead us to the talk or the word tawbatan nasuha, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Tahrim. Alladhina amanu tubu ila Allahi tawbatan nasuha. Do you want to maybe explain about that a little?
Yeah, I mean, tawbatan nasuha, you know, we know what tawbah means. It means like also inaba, like going back to Allah. So when we make a mistake, you know, and all of us will make mistakes. And the Prophet said that the best of us are the ones who make mistakes and then go back to Allah.
Yes.
You know, so all of us, we're going to make mistakes. So all of us, we have to make this tawbah. But the nasuha means it has to be sincere. No. Not just a tawbah which is with done with your mouth, oh Allah, forgive me, and then you carry on. It has to be deep down.
Yes.
And then we go back to some of those conditions that we mentioned before. So with regards to this tawbah, one thing that's very important is that, I remember reading one of the commentaries, and in the Quran it mentions Allahu yahdi man yasha, Allah guides whomever He wishes.
Yes.
And obviously tawbah is from that guidance. But another part of the Quran it mentions tubu is a command from Allah. We have to. It's not like make tawbah if you want.
وَالَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْا زَادَهُمْ هُدًى. The ones who try to earn that guidance, Allah will increase them
in their guidance. So.
So does this mean basically all you have to start doing as a realistic thing for the people maybe who have never done this before is take the first step to Allah. And Allah will take many steps towards you.
Yeah.
Does this generally summarize it?
It summarizes it.
Because I would add to that as a practical rule for someone, that they could probably every day sit down and try to, you know, contemplate what they've done and seek, you know, forgiveness for Allah just before you sleep.
Yes.
You know, hold yourself accountable. Think about what you did for the day and try to, you know, seek istighfar at this time.
Absolutely.
So that way you go to bed with a clean slate.
Coming quickly. One thing that's very important is that we are around people that make istighfar.
Yes.
We are around people that make tawbah and try to improve themselves, because we're all upon the religion or the way of life as our best friends.
Now, one beautiful thing about the verse of Allah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا تُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ تَوْبَةً نَصُوحًا, a real, deep, sincere repentance, a tawbah. Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu added his opinion on this, and perhaps he had learned this from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, this tawbah nasuha is for somebody to repent to Allah from a sin and to never ever go back to it again. Like this person, their sincerity was so great, their remorse was so high, that they never ever went back to that sin again. This is the person who's really happy because they achieved tawbah nasuha. They really got it. And subhanAllah, this reminds us even, you know, at any moment of our lives, we can have this turning point. We're not guaranteed tomorrow. We're not guaranteed the end of Ramadan. We're not guaranteed Laylatul Qadr, even though people think they're sure when it is. We're not guaranteed any of these things because that's in the future. We're guaranteed the current moment that we're in right now. And all we're guaranteed is that as long as we take that first step to Allah, start making istighfar and tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always have the door open for us. The only time the door is shut is when we pass away. So the door of tawbah is always open. It's always there for us. It's always available for us. And maybe we can also now transition to the last condition that we mentioned earlier. So we make tawbah to Allah. And we always want Allah to forgive us, right? We never think, yo, Allah's not going to forgive me. No, we should always think Allah will forgive us. Because Allah loves to forgive. Mm-hmm. What about when people wrong us? Oftentimes our friends or our family members, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our family members, oftentimes they'll wrong us and we'll hold a deep grudge. We'll never forgive them. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to our own shortcomings, our nafs, we let it off the hook easily. Mm-hmm. You know, like it's not a big deal. It's just a small sin. Do you want to add anything to this, Abdullah?
Everything, like, you'll be, like, I don't know how to say it, but like, you'll be accounted for everything.
Yeah.
And like, you should kind of, forgive people. Like, as you said, like, you know, if someone did something bad to me, I would like take it like as a big one. Like, remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all. Like, you know, you should kind of have this kind of attribute as well. I'm not, you're not sharing attribute with Him, but like, you kind of, you know, taking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a role model, and I'll go forgive people as well. And I'll ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this like, as like kind of something to make me like near Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Absolutely. Jazakumullah khairan. So one thing that we remember is when we're reciting Surah Al-Fatiha every single day, we're starting out with this balance of hope and fear and remembering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of all that exists. You know, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're starting with this gratitude. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the one who has mercy even set for all of the creation, and mercy that is specific for the believers. And then Maliki Yawmiddin, we're remembering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of the Day of Resurrection. And that's the day in which we will be standing, we'll be held accountable for our sins. So we're balancing here with this fear of our consequences for our sins, but we're also remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves to forgive. He always loves to forgive. There's nothing that you can do that Allah will not forgive. Nothing. Even, you know, the story, we all know the story about the man who killed 99 people to the end of the hadith, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave him because he started the act of tawbah. He started heading towards the land of tawbah, land of repentance. So anybody who wants to make tawbah or istighfar should start immediately. They shouldn't procrastinate. Maybe what are some of the you know, the effects of somebody procrastinating something as important as tawbah or istighfar?
Effects?
Procrastinating, yes.
I mean, procrastination is from shaitan.
No.
Because Allah tells us that none of us know which land we're going to die in, and none of us know what we're going to earn tomorrow. Exactly. But shaitan always promises us, you can make istighfar, you can make tawbah tomorrow. But we don't know if you're going to reach.
Yes.
So one of the procrastination is actually from shaitan. Because he gives us that belief that actually we're going to, yes, you know, reach that time. And something that you mentioned not too long ago, I just really jarred an incident in my mind, was that I believe it was Abdullah ibn Amr, whom he went and he was in the masjid, and the Prophet said, there's a man of Jannah that's about to come in.
Yeah.
You know, and it was the man. And then 3 days he said this, and the same man's coming in. And from what that's amazing was that his name's not even mentioned in the narration, so no one knows who he is. A random guy. So Abdullah, he goes to his house and says, you know, I've had a problem with my dad, I need to stay with you. And the thing that really struck me was that he just let him stay in his house. I mean, someone came to our houses today.
They had that back then.
They
had to actually host someone. Yeah. Nowadays, somebody comes to your house and you're like, I don't know, you're a stranger.
I don't know you, man.
Stay in my house.
Exactly.
So, 3 days and three nights.
Now, so
go to the hotel.
Yeah. Yeah, so, he observed him and saw that he didn't pray at night time. He wasn't doing any extra fasts. So he says, look, the reason why I'm staying is because the Prophet said that such and such about you, that you're a man of paradise.
Yes.
So what do you do? What is it? And he said that the thing, I can't think of anything, but every night before I go to sleep, I clear my heart of any rancor or ill feelings or issues that I have with anyone.
No.
And Abdullah said, well, that's it.
No.
That's what that deed is. So just coming back to what you mentioned earlier, yeah, on, like, it just popped into my mind. And really it's linked to procrastination because, you know, sometimes deep down we think, I'm going to forgive such and such a person, and we don't do it straight away.
Yes.
We don't actually work at doing it.
Yes.
But we need to understand that, you know, if we can actually have that, where we can, you know, forgive people, then that's a great means of us. It's a great means of us attaining that forgiveness from Allah.
Add on to what you're saying, yes, is that how can you not forgive someone when you want Allah to forgive
exactly
you?
Exactly. That's the point we were trying to get to. Basically, how can you expect Allah to always forgive you? You want it so easily. But when somebody else, a human being who is as flawed as you are, comes to you with something that you might have done to somebody else, it's hard to let them go. And this is a big problem. And subhanAllah, sometimes families are cut off. Sometimes people even divorce, yes, over this. Sometimes friends never, you know, befriend each other ever again. They have this grudge that lasts a lifetime. And this is something that's really bad for the ummah. It's really dangerous for us. And this is something that shaitan wants to divide between us. And this is why the ummah right now, we're suffering because we're always fighting. We're always holding grudges. We're always fighting over, you know, silly things. They're always petty things. And so we seek the forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we always forgive one another. And so maybe we can summarize this topic into three action items. You mentioned the onset of the first one, which is a great action item. Maybe we can agree on this one. Is that every night before you sleep, make sincere tawbah and istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mm-hmm. And so what is the difference between the two? Is that tawbah is specific for a major sin, whereas istighfar is general. Oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, forgive me. So tawbah, oh Allah, forgive me for this sin that I committed. And try as much as possible not to go back to it. Even if you think you're weak and it's a habit, oh Allah, prevent me and protect me from going back to the sin. Make it something that's repulsive to me. Mm-hmm. So every night before we sleep, tawbah and istighfar. Is this a good maybe first action item? That, yes, way, if we have this action item and you died that night in your sleep, you're not going to die with regrets over making tawbah. But a person who says tomorrow and the sun rises and this person doesn't rise, they're going to be filled with grief and regret. Walayadu billah. Maybe a second action item can be related to what Sheikh Ilyas said, is to forgive people all the time. So just like the man of Jannah, whose name we don't know. We just know he was some Ansari man. He didn't even have extra acts of worship, right? The hadith indicates they didn't see him praying at night. He wasn't even fasting by the day. He was just doing his basics. But he cleared his heart every single night from any ill feelings towards other Muslims. And this only matters if somebody actually wronged you. Mm-hmm. So we're not talking if you're just upset for a silly reason. We're talking about if somebody actually wronged you. Somebody hurt you really bad. To find it in your heart to forgive them and not to hold on to that right, because you know that on the Day of Judgment, Allah will give you more than that right that you were owed by this person. So perhaps this could be the second action item. What is maybe a third action item we can add to this related to istighfar or tawbah or seeking the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So perhaps the third thing we can add, inshallah ta'ala, is a dua that we know and we should be teaching our children and our youth and our communities, which is referred to as Sayyid al-Istighfar. And that is Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa ant, to the end of the dua. You're asking, oh Allah, you're my Lord and I am your servant. And you're admitting to the sins that you committed. And you're asking Allah, forgive me. There's no one that can forgive except you. Now, I highly recommend everyone learn this dua, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam indicated whoever makes this supplication in the morning and they die before evening, what is the reward? The one who makes this dua in the morning and dies before evening, they're guaranteed to die on the fitrah. Basically, they're guaranteed Jannah, because they ended their life seeking forgiveness from Allah. So having this ikhlas and this tawheed in their hearts. And whoever says it in the evening and dies before morning is guaranteed Jannah. And so look up this dua. If you don't know it, research the dua. Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa ant. To the end of the dua, it's called Sayyid al-Istighfar. So the three action items we can summarize is to always make tawbah and istighfar, to make it a daily habit, and to always forgive other people, your friends, your family members. Oh Allah, forgive the believing men and the women, those who are alive and those who have passed away. And the third is to learn this dua, Sayyid al-Istighfar, and to include it with the morning and the evening supplications. Is there anything else you guys maybe want to add to these three, inshallah?
No.
Alhamdulillah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our shortcomings. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive everyone who viewed this show, our family members, our friends, everyone around the world. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect the believing men and women and to give us hope and strength throughout our hardships. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant relief to the Muslims who are suffering oppression all around the world. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of the grateful, those who are always appreciative of the food and the blessings that we have. Jazakumullahu khairah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless the guests here, because you guys, mashallah, have done so much and you guys prepared so much, and they took time out of their day to come here, alhamdulillah, and they sacrificed some of that time of ibadah in order to benefit many Muslims around the world. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us and to allow us to see you once again in a future episode, inshallah. Jazakumullahu khaira, wa salli allahumma ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.